Welcome to the Institute of Education at the University of Lisbon. My name is Luis Tinoca, and it's been my pleasure to organize this final event for the European Doctorate in Teacher Education. We are having here in Lisbon the final conference of the project under the topic Transformative Teacher Education for Better Student Learning within an Emerging European Context.
After 3 years of path-taking and path-making, Edite held its final conference under the title Transformative Teacher Learning for Better Student Learning within an Emerging European Context.
To open formally the conference, I have the honor and pleasure to present Professor Luis Miguel Carvalho, President of Instituto de Educação da Universidade de Lisboa, Professor Maria Emília Bradeiro de Santos, President of National Education Council, the partner organization National Representative of our University, Professor Michael Schwartz, Edite European Project Coordinator, and Professor Luis Tinoca, Project Coordinator at IEL Lisboa.
I've already had the chance and the privilege to write 3 reviews on the dissertations which came out of this project. And there's many more to come. And I was really very impressed by what you have achieved.
We learned in other universities or other cultures, there is far more attention which is paid to the doctoral students, because some university structures are fairly tight and lots of burden is pushed on the doctoral students, whereas in other systems, it's more the responsibility of the institution to serve more or less the researchers, to give them the chance to develop, to exceed in what they are doing and to become excellent. And I think this has been something very nourishing in this project, and I appreciate having learned a lot from my colleagues but also from the doctoral students.
Thank you very much for your invitation. Thank you very much for your words introducing myself. I will try to give you a very brief presentation. In fact, I will argue one idea, and in fact it's only one idea. It doesn't mean that there are not many other ideas that are important in teacher education. Of course, you know it much better than me. But I will present this idea almost like a caricature, a very simplistic idea about the idea that the school as you know it, it's reaching the end of historical cycle. And a new thing, something different is at its beginning, which maybe we still call it the school, but which in fact it's a very different thing. That's the beginning of my talk, is the idea of what I've been calling the metamorphosis of the school, the change of the form of the school, the way how the school is changing its form, and at the same time acknowledging that the metamorphosis of the school implies also the metamorphosis of the teaching profession. And that is my argument that goes into detail, and I will say it again and again during my presentation. My point, and that's the main point of my talk with you today, my point is that these metamorphoses, both of the school and of the teaching profession, cannot contribute to a reduction or even to a kind of dissolution of the teaching profession. But in my opinion, it is unfortunately what is happening in many policies and in many tendencies and in many discourses around the world. I'm assisting to this kind of dissolution of the teaching professionality, and that's what I'm trying to argue against, this kind of dissolution, and explaining how teacher education is important in this process. That's why I want to begin this talk with the simplest, but in my opinion, most necessary of all of the statements. And the statement is the following in the beginning of this phrase.
The first day started with a keynote given by Professor Antonio Novoa, a full professor and the honorary rector of the University of Lisbon. His speech on becoming a teacher, on strengthening the profession, critically reflected the current state of play in teaching as profession and provided an interesting input for further discussion. The novel elements of creating a third space that sits between schools and universities as places of teacher professionalism inspired a fruitful debate and was a point of reference for the rest of the conference. The overall theme of the conference drew on the independence of educational research and practice offered throughout the Edite program and exploited the notions and ambitions of becoming the leading European network for innovation in teacher education, accessible to academics, practitioners and policymakers. The three pillars, teacher learning, student learning and the European context, were explored on different levels and through different perspectives, looking at it from a wide range of approaches taken by the Edite researchers in their studies, but also from the approaches of practicing teachers that attended the conference. The stimulating discussion continued with an interactive roundtable on policy and teacher education, depicting views from Manuel Migenj from the National Education Council, Gabor Halash from ELTE University, and Vasilis Simonidis, an Edite researcher from University of Innsbruck.
Profession. And I was asking the habitual question, what do you think, what percentage of what you, what percentage of the skills you were using in your lesson you learned at the university, what percentage of the knowledge you need for this kind of work came from your university studies? And she was thinking and then answering that, well, perhaps 10 or 15%.
Roundtable talks in Poland, which happened during the transition from communism to democracy. So during those talks, the topic of autonomy or democratization or teachers' role was discussed.
So at one hand, people like Professor Lopold rightly so, because I was very impressed with what he said, said we have to educate a new educational profession, professional teachers.
In the case of my university, we tried to give a very strong specific focus to the research activity within Edite, and this was teacher learning. So we defined, we constructed a research program focusing on teacher learning, named the Learning Teacher. That's the name of the research program we implemented in Edite, which was focusing, which has been focusing on areas like how teachers are learning when they are working in an innovative workplace, or what teachers can learn, or teacher educators can learn from the way other professions are learning, or what the role of the practical training, what role it plays in the development of skills. So that was a quite structured research. Well, as for the whole Edite and the broader European context, we agreed to give a quite specific focus for the research in Edite. This is about how teacher learning can support pupil learning in an emerging European context. Some of the research projects conducted by the doctoral students were very, very closely connected with this broader topic. Others were more loosely connected to this. So, so now I am talking mainly about those who were really focusing on this program. I would say that this way, editor could call the attention. The editor research could call the attention to the topic, to the theme of teacher learning. And this is important because there seems to be a an emerging consensus in Europe and also globally that the most important factor of effective pupil learning is the quality of the work of teachers. It is the quality of the skills, the competences they have, their behavior, their attitudes, the methodological repertoire they use in their daily work. And these skills, this repertoire, these behavioral traits, they can be acquired only through learning, a special form of professional learning. This is what we call teacher education, although personally me, I prefer talking about teacher learning. So in this perspective, the role of teacher educators is to help, to facilitate, to support the learning of teachers, not only in at the beginning of their career, but during the whole course of their life. So now I think that, thanks partly to Edite, we know more about how teachers learn and how this learning can be made more effective and how this learning can improve the quality of their daily work.
And I was wondering, considering the focus then of your research project, how has this theoretical underpinning that you've chosen helped you to then, when you move on to the class and when you are looking at how communication is flowing?
Because I think that people think about the techniques, innovations, but in fact when you go to the class, you have to encourage your students to think, to reflect.
The afternoon continued to feed on interesting conversations through parallel sessions in which some editor researchers presented their doctoral studies. The last part of the first day was dedicated to practical sessions called reflective circles, interactive spaces where research and practice meet, and where concepts get rediscovered, collectively analyzed and reconstructed. One such session was facilitated by Victor Bernard and Wanderson Alexander Oliveira in Portuguese.
Afraid. Some people who are keen to.
And the other was in English, facilitated by Helena Kovacs.
For a very short period of time. What I mean is that each group will have people who will have a challenge.
Give one example, for example,
they are about a bit, no?
I want them to look at the book, at the student's book, and to ask additional questions.
My specific topic is teacher learning in innovative learning environments, and I find this topic quite attractive, quite well synchronized with what we're seeing today in the world. If we think of teacher learning as a very important topic, as a topic which continuously needs to be discovered and rediscovered, reframed, because teacher learning is very contextual, teacher learning is very intimate and also very, very, it's not explicit. We don't know how it happens. We don't really know all the outcomes of it. So this is a topic that continuously needs to be rediscovered, and hence it's very important to be addressed over and over and over again. And if we think about the specific context that I take into consideration in my research, the innovative schools. So these are schools that are kind of breaking the rules, doing something new, doing something meaningful. This really excites me. The innovative part really excites me, and it was the most difficult part to also define, because what is innovation? I would go to interviews, and the first question we start to discuss, it's not how they learn or how they communicate or how they do their teaching, what their behavior entails in the classroom, but what is innovation? What can we call innovation? Is innovation in one context the same as in the other? And these are crucial questions. And since innovation is so diversified and so contextual as well, it has to be discovered over and over again. It has to be looked from a very specific, very comprehensive kind of a way. The same again, if I go back to teacher learning, the same goes for teacher learning. It's not just one person's learning. It's a whole system. It's a school level, it's at national level, and so on.
Just like you, I started out as a student.
The second day brought an inspiring keynote on practitioner research as brave research towards inclusive and diverse inquiry, given by Dr. Anja Svennen of Vrije University, Amsterdam.
Because what I see in my country, only statistical research counts. That is not always, sometimes it is, it's not always the most valuable research for the teachers. Bright research, which you said was the two things of being courageous, but also doing something that maybe not everybody does. So let's start with my first slide. Does it?
No man has gone before.
It was a different time. We only say man when we meant people, but anything. Yeah. That was the last frontier. Yeah. We still have to step over that one, but I love it. I love Star Trek. So I hear insider perspective. Because if you research something, you have to hear the voices of the people who are in the field. Great research is. But it's much more than the traditional research that the academic researchers. I don't know, the traditional researchers, shall we call them traditional researchers? The one who says, I know what I want to research, I'm going to do it in the methodology that is fit and accepted, and the outcomes are objective. Our research, to use yesterday's term, is much more fluent. It's also working with your students. It's research projects of your students. It's working with teachers on research. It's including two teachers in serious matter in your research, etc. One of the things that I think that could bring us to the points that I mentioned before in brave research, two different PhD students. Now you must know that if a PhD student in the Netherlands is at a traditional research university, they are paid as junior researchers.
Today I'm going to present you this presentation, which I called Empowering Teachers' Competence, Development Education, which is my focus. My focus is to present...
The discussions continued with a rich interactive roundtable about diversity, inclusion and equity, featuring Helena Salema from University of Lisbon, David Rodriguez, the president of Pro Inclusion, and Josephine Wagner, an editor researcher from the University of Lower Silesia.
And what kind of behaviors they should have. So we have all these subjects, all right, about this document. This subject, global development education, nowadays in Portugal is very well, developed, or it's very new, let's say. And even the last, the government, in fact, published in published a new curricular area, which is called Citizenship and Development.
I will drop a few ideas about teacher education and inclusion. When I say a few ideas, as you imagine, it's a huge subject. It's a huge subject, but of course we have to make a long story short, and I'll try to be very short about this. First of all, let me tell you about inclusion in Portugal, because we have probably a system in Portugal that is not very common in other countries. For the moment, we have 98% of children with disabilities are educated in regular schools in Portugal. 98%. And that means that we have a bet. We had a very powerful bet in inclusion, especially of children with difficulties of learning disabilities, with learning disabilities and other kinds of disabilities. So 98% are in schools, and we have an organization that is paying for 7,500 teachers of special education in schools. 7,500 teachers of special education is the second largest group in Portugal of teachers. The first are primary teachers, and second is teachers of special education. That is, in our schools, most of our schools have 3-4 teachers of special education, and that is a huge group to think about that education.
We'll quickly have to share that in Portugal there are also a lot of associations which are related to neighborhoods or certain areas. And they have also a lot of programs for families and children, and they do a lot of work. And I think maybe one thing that academia could do is actually to work more with the associations, because it could be okay. So, Hannah?
In trying to grapple with it and help kids, but in most of the cases that you described in your work, there is a resistance to it, passive or active resistance to the inclusion of to inclusion. And it doesn't matter if it's immigrant kids or if it's kids with disabilities. And I think, you know, I don't know how to put this, but I think, you know, it's a question. I think it's so much tied to Europe and where we are at this point, and to the future of the European project, and to humanity, you know, and to think to our imaginations of who we are to be as Europeans, and what you know. And I think inclusion, in some way, like breaks this. It's this breaking point because it's about children.
I'm an early stage researcher with Edite. And I have recently been awarded a PhD degree by both the University of Innsbruck and ELTE University in Hungary. This 3 years experience has been really a privilege for me participating in Edite, because I had the chance to conduct my research on teacher education in a European transnational context, which means that while I was based in Innsbruck, I had the chance to undertake a mobility of 6 months in Budapest, Hungary, and be able to also conduct my research there. But also throughout these 3 years, we had the chance to be part of many summer schools and virtual seminars that brought the community from so many different universities together to exchange thoughts about teacher education. During the project, a great experience was the fact that I could also work together with many partner institutions that we had at each of the universities, so schools and other policy institutions that I could conduct my research, but also feed my research back into them in a meaningful way. And I'm happy that I was given this opportunity to conduct this with such a good working conditions within such a European endeavor. I'm currently here in Lisbon at the final Edite conference, and I'm happy because since I have graduated, I have applied for a postdoctoral position at the University of Innsbruck, which I am starting in 1 month from now, and I will be able to continue my research at another postdoctoral level.
The afternoon of the second day offered a changed perspective and took place in a physical setting of the Edite Partner School, Escola Secundaria Padre Antonio Vieira, Alvalade, where a panel of school teachers and principals presented their work. This prompted a discussion on school-university partnership, which spanned into the last session of the day, facilitated by the team from ELTE Budapest.
The first project is about student-centered learning for autonomy. It's from the Alvalade School group. We are very pleased to have the school group principal here, which is Dulce Sagas. And the presenting teacher from this school cluster is Teresa Nunes. This cluster has 2,100 pupils in this cluster in 4 schools. This cluster collaborates also with the teacher training center and the Center for Lifelong Vocational Training. The second project, which we will listen to, or the presentation we will have today later on, is about teacher collaborative supervision in schools. I will talk about this in a minute.
On time management. The third step is the class observation. The positive aspects and those in need of improvement. Here are some examples that Teresa will talk about. Like,
we trust, we get along okay, and we're not afraid to say what we think of what they did in the class. So I choose someone that is in the board direction because she was evaluated and assessed by our principal, so it was safe to do with some comfort. And I, and not all my group, my department, think is not to give up of the control of the curriculum, because when we put kids in groups, what are they doing? Because I'm not controlling. So it was difficult initially and was one of the focus. How does the teacher let go of that control, and how does he check if they are learning? So what is happening in the groups when the teacher is not there? Because we think, we imagine that we control everything when we are looking at the students saying to all the same thing. And that is not true. I learned it a long time ago in a very difficult school, with a difficult neighborhood, so socially very, very poor. And it was, I had to change, because if I did not change, I would lose all my students in the class.
We, the Hungarian team, proposed in the framework of our work package 5. I wonder whether everyone knows that we have in the EDITA program work packages. And one of the work packages is work package 5, which is about building partnerships. And our university is responsible for managing this work package. Well, we think that this event could have two goals. One is to present you the first outcomes of a research which is being carried on in the framework of Work Package 5 with the aim of building knowledge about partnership building, school-university partnership, and enriching the research program of EDITE with this. So this is one goal, to give a first feedback about the outcomes of this ongoing research. And the other goal is to support knowledge building, which can be used in this research, I repeat, which aims to enrich the EDITE research program. So this event is about shared spaces. So we heard a lot about shared spaces in the last 1.5 days. But this shared space we are talking about here is not exactly the same as what Professor Nova was talking about in the first day in his keynote speech, because he was talking about a shared space where teacher educators and teachers met together with some other stakeholders. But in this case, those who are meeting in this shared space are researchers.
So you mentioned that it was interesting to you that somebody pointed out that there was a partner school that was, or there was a school involved in research, but it wasn't a partner organization. And so I also had, I recruited myself and I had partner organization schools in my research. And I found the difference very interesting because oftentimes the partner organization schools are in a way prepared and used to researchers, so they are oftentimes how can I say it? Yeah, inviting in a way, and the recruited school required a different approach simply. But I thought both were very interesting approaches towards school, and I'm wondering
one way or another, or kind of has some risks, I would say. But you know, if we think of strategically planning research, then of course partner organization schools are a fantastic way of making the research more predictable in a way. And yeah, but I was just wondering what your thoughts are and how you want to.
Thank you for being here. I also would like to congratulate the organizers and all those involved in EDITE Network.
Arriving to the third day, Maria Assunção Flores, a professor at the University of Minho, opened the debates with her keynote, Teacher Education and Professionalism in the Digital Era. What's new?
That's the central theme of this conference. How can we best educate teachers and foster their learning so that pupils can learn more effectively in current contexts which are marked by an accelerated pace of change? I guess this is a common concern for all of us as teacher educators and researchers. As I was asked to talk about teacher professionalism, I have decided to look at current challenges of schools and teachers' work, taking into account the digital era in which we live and drawing upon research in which I have been involved. I will bring here some of the teachers' voices and also the pupils' voices. So I will try to share with you especially with teachers' voices and how they think, how they feel, and what they do in schools and classrooms. So let me start with some questions for which I don't have any answers. I have some thoughts, so that's what I'm going to share with you. how do pupils learn in the digital era? How do we teach in this to be seen as a cultural space and a knowledge hub, which requires teachers and students to work in different ways? I would say more complex ways, in the light of plural understandings and practices of teacher professionalism, which in turn imply a careful look into teacher education to prepare knowledgeable teachers, but also teachers who demonstrated the mastery of multiple literacies.
In how society sees teaching profession, how society sees teachers as a profession, and how what awareness our society. So we are part of our society. So what do we face if we talk about the teaching profession? It's society developments, individualization. We know that versus logical communitization. So we are going back to locus, to very ideological.
The proposed question was further look at from different aspects of the interactive round table involving Christina Kraller from University of Innsbruck, Petr Navotny from Masaryk University, and Mariana Feju, a PhD in teacher education.
Myriad tasks we face as teachers. We are facing a number of challenges. We are facing the fluid world, to put it short.
But are being used for different purposes. The phenomenon of social reproduction influences the tough situation of the pupil with dyslexia. The next generations are being taught the stigmatized value. The school career and future students' social position are...
In the afternoon, the conversations again became diverse and split into smaller parallel sessions, where the rest of the Edite researchers presented their doctoral studies.
And therefore, I conceptualize in this sense Europeanization more as policy learning that is not only happening from the EU as downloaded to the member states, but they're learning together. So policy learning process more as a horizontal rather than top-down or bottom-up idea.
His counterpart mentions 171 schools associated in a kind of democratic club.
And it is created among teachers in schools that are considered as learning environments. So this is something that I took very much into account.
This was the first time where the discussion came. How do teachers actually feel that they not just teach in or for Austria, in Greece, for Greece, in wherever, and think of the whole of what it means to be a teacher in Europe? And we've had lots of discussion, and this has been developed, this idea, but then we realized and that was the next step coming out of ENTEP, the European Network of Teacher Education Policies. We should get the idea of Europe into teacher education, but it's very difficult to get hold of all the teacher educators. We heard that from Anya and several other people. They are lost in Spain. Doctorate in teacher education was born. And we have had the marvelous experience now with all of you. Lost, they went into something, what we call a position paper, which we want to introduce so as to have at least some stepping stone to build on before we go into the discussion, which Vasily still talked about.
The conference and the third day were closed by a final session on Edite 2.0, Emerging Future. Cycling initial ideas proposed through a position paper prepared by Anya Svenen, Michael Schratz and Vasilis Simeonidis. The input from small group discussions inspired further thinking of the future of the Edite network, its potential transformation and growth.
Okay, thank you. I will not talk long. I just wanted to say that for this session we structured it in that way that we put together some ideas that we think from the past experience, but also from what we have learned and what we see are the strengths of the Edite project, how can we envision and further develop the future. So we thought of drafting a position paper which you will have the challenge to challenge and utopia or a vision of how we would see the project, let's say, or how we would like the project to be in 10 years. And then which are those identify or those key elements of the project that we want to see into the future. We would like Edite, and we put them here as 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and we want you to reflect perhaps on one of them, on all of them, adding new things.
Yes.
I slide into the position to speak with Professor Nova of the teacher. We have here a few papers. I'm going to you give them to people, but I need one to look at. We did prepare a real workshop, so we set you to work. Initially, we thought about just talk about it, but talk about the position paper and talk about the future of Edite. But we thought that would be a little bit free, and we are not sure we would have the results that we would expect of you. So what we did, we made kind of activity plan, which you can see on this side of the page. And I'm not sure that I want for everybody, so you have to look together. That's a good start for collaboration. Now, we have already subgroups, but initially we thought you can sit in any group you want. So if you don't like the group you're in now, you can switch.
Does it mean kind of position paper? Does it mean kind of institutionalization?
While the conference in Lisbon was indeed a crowning event for the Edite network, the work does not end here. There is still plenty of interesting PhD studies to be finalized in the next few months, and we can anticipate an online seminar in late spring that will further the academic discussions on teacher learning and give ground to continuous conversation about where is Edite heading next.
We feel that this mobility is what creates all the possibilities of the transnational and transpositional researches that that happens in this project.
Okay.
It is essential.
Yes.
Another thing we felt immensely important is to have this linking of teacher education with the schools, universities, all kinds of partner institutions, non-profit organizations, freelancers, but also we feel that there might be something missing from this, that a connection with the commission or policymakers of the European Union is missing from this paper, that we would feel that the Edite 2.0 by 2030 would be a major player in the European education transformation business. Edite would provide research background to decisions and vice versa. Decision makers would ask the Edite to help them. That's something.
Yeah.
Sorry.
I think, for instance, trust, respect, transparency. And we can go on. But these words, we thought there are some words that should be in this document. The second point that we decided to bring to the table was our discussion of the concepts of Europeanness or in Europe and European. So the question of European doctorate in teacher education, does that limit, does that liberate, and then in what way? Who owns Edite as such?
Yep. Okay, thank you very much.
Thank you very much for the position paper and the 3 points. The first one is to step back one step and look at the partner universities, how much they can undertake, how much responsibilities they can take in the future for Edite. What are they willing to do and so on?
I think it would be better to concentrate more on a topic and align everything more to a particular direction we go. Because what I found very difficult we had a wide span of topics which were dealt with. And this, of course, is very difficult to cater for, particularly in supervision, and also from learning from each other. So just, for example, to look closer at what does innovation mean, and then everybody trying to look at innovation and look at it from different perspectives and build the puzzle parts together to get to the bigger whole. And this is, I think, what we are venturing at when we talk about the emerging Europe. We don't want to have isolated pieces around. We rather want to align what's there, value the strengths of each country, of each culture, but see what's the added value of all them together. And this is, I think, what the doctoral students have tried to do anyway. And I'm very glad that they have such rich contents in their dissertations, at least the ones I've supervised so far.
Yay! Okay.